Attention all units, we have a movie in progress. Repeat units, we have a movie in progress.
15 take off.
Watch it, buddy. Good movie.
This is Hubbardston, Mass., founded in 1767, population 3,000. A typical small New England town located in the rolling hills of central Massachusetts. Its town center contains many buildings and homes of historic note and a timeless town common with its memorial to native sons who have sacrificed their lives for their town and country, and which sits before a church of long history and note. The strength of Hubbardston lies in the nature of its residents. While they don't always agree on everything, they do join together to support local community activities. An example of this is the Hubbardston Community Park. And over the years, neighbors have come together to lend a helping hand when disaster or need occurs. This film is only a brief view of a town that is full of activity and vitality. Please relax and enjoy Hubbardston, the movie.
This building on the corner of Main and Elm Street is the old Wheeler Brothers store. Cy Wheeler ran the store until 1968 when he retired. Cy carried a wide selection of penny candy, ice cream, and other goodies one could ask for. He always had a story to tell or something interesting to show. The store originally owned by Abias S. Clark, the store has been in the Wheeler family since 1875.
Brother's store on the corner of Main Street and Elm Street. When I was a little boy, I used to come here and buy penny candy, and Cy Wheeler used to tell me about these caves up on the back road. This here is the biggest cave that Cy Wheeler told me about. When my brother and I were very young, we used to walk up into this cave here. We put candles along the side, and there's a little room up there that we used to sit up there. And just at the side here, there's windows in here, that there must be a chamber that goes down into this room inside the ledge, but there's so much porcupine manure in here that it's filled it all in. He would not tell me about the next cave until I proven to him that I've been to this one.
Here you see the three windows up here carved in the rock, like a vent window, and on the bottom it looks like a clean out hole. Now this hole right here, I set a fire, and smoke came out of the three windows, and about 300 feet away, there's a little hole carved in the rock that smoke came out of.
This small cave is interesting because it's obviously a non-natural phenomenon. It's been created by man somehow. You could tell by the rounded roof here that's actually been worked over a long period of time. It's fairly smooth, and it has the appearance that it was either there was some kind of mining operation here, or else it was just hollowed out as a shelter. There's a lot of debris on the floor here, and it would be interesting to carefully dig down here and see what kind of evidence we find. If this was worked, and I'm pretty sure it was, you'll find some tools in this debris here. Give an idea of how it was worked. Because this is close to the copper mine here in Hubbardston, one guess might be that somebody found a vein here. The Indians knew about copper, and in South America they were very elaborate smelters for extracting copper metal out of copper ore. This was not free copper, but copper compounds that were found in the earth. And as far as I know, there's been no one has ever found any evidence of copper smeltering this far in North America. But if they did, it would be very interesting. It would be a very unique site. This site could be connected with the pre-Columbian extraction of copper.
You see, to get up to this ledge here, you do have quite the climb.
This is interesting because it isn't in solid rock. It's made of pieces of rock piled together. But some of them are so big, like this one here, that they must have been here originally.
This is when I went down in this one and I came out where Jesse is.
Oh. Yeah, this is a pretty big hole in here. Right off New Templeton Road, at an interesting site here, where we have a underground chamber running out. It's more than 20, probably about 30 feet long here. And it looks like it may have been at least partially constructed by man, in that there's a natural cleavage between the structure here and some pretty good sized flat rocks have been moved over this cleavage to create the space underneath. And there's quite a few of these flat rocks here. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, another one behind me. And these are flat rocks, you can see, have come right off the top of the ledge here. So it could be that this structure was created by simply sliding these rocks over here. And it looks like it's quite elaborate. There's passageways that go out this way and that come out this way, several entrances over there. The beehive structure in Petersham, while it's completely man-made, the walls are stonework walls. The roof of it is made with flat rocks, just like these, that was slid over the walls and then covered with earth. So what we might be looking at here is a sort of a primitive version of a beehive structure, which, as far as we know, dates from before the time of Christ. The first cave we looked at, the one with the three smoke holes, that turned out to be a cave that we were used by the original inhabitants of this area. That would be interesting, because it would probably be a Paleolithic site. In other words, dating back to the time of the Ice Age.
This is Big Rock, located on New Templeton Road. It's been an attraction for Hubbardston residents for many years, as can be seen in this 1900 photograph.
Hubbardston was once a big farming community. We had the Grange, and we had the Farmers Co-op, and now this is the last of the big dairy farms.
I think it's a wonderful community. I grew up on a farm. I enjoy the farm community, and I think we can be a great asset to the community and also help the people that work here with us. Thank you.
I'm back to my childhood. What I found, I did not see. guess I knew there'd be some changes. When progress comes, you sort of go along. But it happened just oh so completely that I found the very creek that I knew is gone.
One-man patrol. With the new roads that have been built in the last couple years with the developments, we got well over 100 miles of road in this town. And that's a real lot. We're like the third biggest town in this state, area-wise. I'm very active in the field day that we have. We usually have to set up the jail and bail program that we have, where you can lock somebody up for a dollar. And the kids really get a kick out of that. It's a good time. We have, you know, it's all donated time by the police officers. We set up the jail, we work it all day, and we enjoy it. And it's just to get to know the kids a little bit better.
The Lions Club sponsors Field Day and other fundraisers for several community projects. Every year they put on a Thanksgiving dinner for our senior citizens.
But the clouds, they will soon fly. The sunny side of
the Lions are putting on a spaghetti supper to raise money to buy sports equipment for the school.
Hi, I'm Sam Isgro, president of the Hubbardston Lions Club, and I'm proud to be involved in one of the largest projects this club has ever undertaken. And with the town of Hubbardston's support, it will be something that we will all be proud of for years to come. Now I'd like to introduce the originator and longtime club member, Bob Cohen.
Thanks, Sam. About a year and a half ago, I felt the town needed something to bring them together as a family. What better way than a bandstand for all to enjoy? I brought this idea up at a Lions meeting, and they all felt it was a good idea. So as a Lions group, we all went out and have worked to make this come true. With the help of many, many contributors for our labor, supplies, and money, we're on our way.
We go fishing down here a lot, and there's pretty big bass down here, usually a couple pounds, and pickerel, sometimes bluegill. We like fishing down here, me and him. It's the only place we can really go fishing since a lot of ponds now are bought out.
Nice place.
If you fish Morgan Pond, you can't help but notice this mansion overlooking the water. It is part of the Ron Burton training camp here in Hubbardston.
It's been a few years since Ron Burton hung up his Boston Patriots jersey, but sports fans everywhere haven't forgotten the gridiron thrills Ron gave them as an All-American running back at Northwestern University, and for six exciting seasons with the Patriots. And Ron hasn't forgotten. He hasn't forgotten the values that were important to him as a star high school athlete in Springfield, Ohio. Values his grandmother taught him. Work hard. Be a team player. Strive for excellence. Respect the feelings of others. Ron always maintains he's been successful through hard work, not talent. Excellence means commitment. He ran 7.5 miles a day every day for 12 years. In 1955, Ron Burton received scholarships from 47 universities. He didn't have much money. He didn't have much except his values and his commitment.
Here we are at the home of Ron Burton here in Hubbardston. And how long have you lived here now?
We've been out here since 1985. And we started at that point and trying to put it all together. And I never forget when I found, located the property from some people in Hubbardston. And the moment I laid eyes on the town and the atmosphere that you had out here, I knew this is the place I'd like to be. Express the fact that many years ago, when people helped me, I wanted to figure out a way where I could pay back a portion that's been given to me. And I've been so blessed. And the guy up above has just been so gracious to me in a way that I've had the opportunity to help out. And that's what this camp's all about. We bring young people together, ages 12 to 17. And a typical day here, we go to bed at 7:30 at night. We get up at 4 in the morning. As I said before, they run 8 miles before breakfast. And what happens is that we have a routine whereby as soon as you get back from breakfast, the 8 mile run, then you have the shower, then you have the breakfast, then we have an exercise program, and then from there first we have a nap before we go into our exercises for about an hour. And from there the exercise and then the lunch. And after lunch we have a reading period where we have to go through whereby we have word vocabulary, because we have to express the importance of education. Because without the knowledge or education or the emphasis on it, you won't get very far. And so after that, we have competition where we play basketball against each other, we play touch football, we play volleyball, and all the fun games. And then after that, we do a lot of relays, a lot of running, a lot of sprinting. But we do it all in a fun manner, where you have a lot of fun, you're working like mad, but you get a lot of work done. And we do that up until 5 o'clock, and by the time we finish all that running, you know, you get to be in pretty good shape after you're out here for 5 straight weeks of, you know, going that regimentation of going to bed at 7:30 at night, up at 4, the 8 miles, and all the running and the playing. But you feel so good about yourself. And we have computers here where we stress the importance of computer training and the vocabulary. And so we get sort of a well-rounded person by the time we get finished. We provide every kid with his shoes, his socks, his sweats, his pillows, his sheets. You bring nothing, and every kid's alike here. You can't tell a rich kid from a poor kid, but we don't have any rich kids here. We have, but everyone feels good about themselves, and everything is free play. And what we try to teach them more than anything else is how to love one another.
Thank you,
Gary. It's a pleasure meeting you. I say that very sincerely. The people I've met here in town, I've enjoyed this, and they've been out here. And I love having the kids out here on the soccer field, and that means a great deal to me. And one of these days, if I stop long enough, there's so many things I'd like to do for some of the kids here in Hubbardston. But my problem is I only have so much time, because in the moment this is over, I got to leave, because I've used up more than my vacation and I've been allowed it. But my company, John Hancock, knows what I'm trying to do, and they've been very good to me.
in relationships because they know the problems. And there's a lot of young people who really appreciate what you do.
Yep. Yeah, it looks like you got quite the training center here. And next in the video here, we're going to look at the Hubbardston school system and how it's changed over the years, way back to the one-room schoolhouse where my dad went to.
Well, I went grammar school at the corner here, corner of 68 in Pitcherville and Morgan Road, up to sixth grade, and then we went from there to Hubbardston, where Mrs. Ed Prentice's wife lives. That was the grammar school that I went to. And Carol Clark lived on High Street. He used to have a pickup truck with two benches on it and a roof that he used to pick us up from here to grammar school. That's about all I know.
The old center school used for the last time in the school year 38-39 was vintage antique education in the United States. The autumn of 1938, there was a new building in the process of construction. And at the same time, the old building, with all the values that the old building contained, was still active. I spent the first year of my time in Hubbardston in the old building. Let me give you a brief picture of it. Four spacious rooms, heated by potbelly stoves, the teacher's desk on a raised platform in front, desks nailed to the floor.
I was in the fifth grade the year before center school opened, so I was pretty young at the time. But it seems to me that the planning for center school began in about 1936 as a PWA project. 1937 and 38, it was under construction, and it opened in the fall of 1939. That was the first year that the students from center school and the students from number 3 school on Gardner Road, where Giuseppe Axe now live, went to the same school together. So it was an interesting new mix of people. Yeah. The new wing was built in, was completed approximately in 1954. And I was teaching in New York State at the time construction was underway. But my mother, Lillian, now Lillian Washburn, was on the committee, and I know Ray Moore was on the construction committee. And we hoped that was going to solve our problems for many years to come, and it did. And up until the present need for a very dramatic expansion due to the very dramatic expansion in the population of Hubbardston.
Hennigan Richard, I have to say the name Hennigan because I wrote the song under the name Hennigan. And I wrote the words to the song and Hazel Hall Lewis, and I wrote the music to the song. And I believe it was 1951 Hazel. We're over to Hazel's house one evening and the class had asked us, or had asked me to write a class song, which I did, to the tune of Mockingbird Hill. And that was not appropriate for really a school song, and they wanted a school song. So one evening, Hazel and I got together at Hazel's home, and I sat down and wrote a poem, which Hazel put the music to, and you can tell them a little bit about the music.
Well, we put the words down on a piece of music paper and set it to the 4-4 rhythm, and broke it down and sort of hummed a little tune, and that was the beginning of it, and it just developed into a song that they seemed to like when I played it. I'm very, very partial to that type of music anyway. I was very good at playing that style of music. And the kids liked it, so we just developed it into a, so it became what it is today.
We thought it was just going to be for that year.
Yes.
We never realized it was going to be immortalized and become a school song. But we're very proud of having it.
I'm Nancy Kangas. I started first grade at Hubbardston Center School in 1955. And Mrs. Prime was my first grade school teacher, and I understand that was her first year in Hubbardston. So we'd like to hear about your years in Hubbardston Center School.
Well, I came in 55, and at that time there was just the old building. And they had two rooms in back of the cafeteria, and I had one of those downstairs rooms. And it had a stairwell that went right outdoors. And at that time, some of the grades were doubled up. And it was that year that they built the new addition. And during the year, we moved into the other part of the building.
I can remember that.
Yes. And then the Slate Building came later. And when they built that, I moved over there.
Well, how does it feel to see some of your previous students grown up now? And then I guess you've had some of our children.
David Arm I had in the first grade, and I had his son, and Joe Gardinowicz, I had two of his sons. And I was trying to think, there must be some others, but offhand I can't remember who they were. Well, it seems funny, these kids grow up and I don't change, so I think they're going to catch up with me.
Well, I want to thank you for spending this time with us, and I want to say you were one of my favorite teachers for
well,
my years.
Well, thank you.
I know. Thought of you and Mrs.
Mrs.
Parent.
Parent was your favorite, I know.
Yeah.
Yes, she was wonderful.
Well, you both have helped me out in my life, and I appreciate it.
I really enjoy it. It's so much fun to see the kids and see how nicely they've turned out and everything. And you see you two doing so well.
Well, so thank you very much, and God bless you.
Well, same to you, and God bless you.
In April of this year, the Lions Club felt that if we could get enough people together, enough community involvement, that we'd be able to paint the whole Hubbardston School in one day. And that's how the start of Operation Facelift began. Today we're applying about 210 gallons of paint, and we have about, as I said, 225 people. The cost of it, for materials-wise, is about $5,000. The cost, if we were going to have it professionally done, would probably be somewhere between $65,000 to $75,000. It's just been very heartwarming, the show-up and turnout we've had. It tells me that the grassroots in Hubbardston really run deep.
I think it's fantastic. I think the town spirit is really great, and Hubbardston always comes forward when they're needed. And we all, special thanks to Ed Blanchard and his crew, because Ed's done a fantastic job.
My feeling is the community is saying to us in the school that we're making a commitment to these children and we're making a commitment to the future of Hubbardston. And it's now up to us here at the school to carry that commitment forward and to work with the people here and to provide the best possible education we can.
Section. This connects into the center core by A section, which is connected to the old building. This building here, we're shooting to complete this building project by February of 1992, so that the students can move from the old section of the school into the new section. This is B section has two floors. A section has two floors, and then the center core has two floors. And what you see here now is the masonry going up. The masonry is complete on these sections, showing at this time. They're starting on the brickwork. Area walkway, eating area, and cafeteria, with two bathrooms down by the gymnasium.
Are we putting a wall up here?
Yes, this is all glass. This main entrance is all glass. There's a 2-foot difference in elevation.
Jonas Clark decided to do after he turned down on the college was to provide us with a municipal free public library, which Hubbardston did not have. And so he donated, and later on his trustees donated the rest of the land. He donated first the land with the where the building was to be put and paid for its construction. Jonas Clark was born in Hubbardston, became a very successful businessman during the period of the Civil War, built a house on Main Street that still has his name and title to it, then wanted to endow the town of Hubbardston with a wonderful college which was to become Clark University. The townspeople turned him down. They didn't want a rowdy group of people coming into town young.
The post office was originally in the library building. I remember when we had upstairs was the Grange Hall, and the Grange used to meet there. And then the post office moved over across the street in 1962.
Okay, we have over 500 post office boxes right now, and we also have about 1,200 street deliveries that we do. So Hubbardston has really grown. We handle about approximately 500,000 pieces of mail a year, which is a lot of mail. And with the growth, we're growing all the time. We have two routes going from one big one to two bigger ones. Each piece is individually sorted to the address that it's going to. And put in order, delivery order.
The fire department for the last couple of years has been averaging a call about once a day or once every day and a half. And it's been that way now for about 2 years, 3 years, I would say. And it's mainly because of the influx of population into the community. At some point in time, we're going to need to have some permanent people here to handle the various things that need to be taken care of. It's true that the majority of our calls are medical related. We had somewhere in the vicinity of 88 medical emergency calls and an additional 40 to 50 automobile accidents in which there were personal injuries. Route 68 becomes very busy in the months of summer months with the flea market and traffic on weekends and the campgrounds and various things. And so we're responding on a regular basis to vehicle accidents and medical emergencies that occur in the town. We provide the service. We provide, as far as the medical end of it is concerned, we respond to these calls. We do have the 911 system now where people can call in on the 911 line and we will respond. We are maintaining our existing emergency lines at this particular time because a lot of the older people in the community will always remember that fire emergency line 3333, and so it's going to take many years in which there will be a turnover people to get used to the 911 line, and then we have some plans for the 333 line afterwards. Essentially, a day here at the fire station is always something going on here. Mm-hmm. It's a very busy place. We just try to do what we have to do, and the people are dedicated and devote a lot of time here. Mm-hmm. And I hope the people of our community appreciate that.
Well, what do you think?
Holy mackerel, he's right.
You got we can hang it on the porch door tomorrow.
Hi, I'm Marion Lyon, and I'm a potter. Love working in the clay. And this piece I'm working on has to do with a grape design, where I have used grape leaves to impress the design in the clay. And sort of use the combination of a wheel-thrown piece and a hand-built piece on the top. I do lots of utilitarian kinds of pottery, too, things to be used in the kitchen and in the home. But I really, my real love is to be able to use this kind of sculptural process.
Hi, my name is Lee Perrin, and I'm a bird carver. This is a swan that I started a couple of weeks ago, and I'm in the middle of painting it at the moment. It takes about 40 to 60 hours to complete this bird, and I've probably got another 15 to 20 left to go.
I'm Stan Parita. I'm a watercolor artist here at Hubbardston, and I work mainly in landscapes of the local area. I'm going to do a watercolor of Bent's Pond in winter. I'd like to do a very quick sketch, nothing very elaborate, and this is going to be a painting showing the the ice on Bent's Pond. I like to work fast and loose in my watercolors. I don't like to spend a lot of time doing detailed work in the beginning. I like to get the big shapes in. And here I'm going to draw some ice. So I'm going to make that going to be a purplish color. And off in the distance here, I'm going to have some trees just over the horizon where there's snow. I like to use some unconventional techniques, like splattering paint on my picture and seeing what happens, and working around these accidents to get the effect that I'm after. Oh, there's one more spot I want to do right here, and I think that'll be it. I'm Don Lytle, enamelist extraordinary. This is the raw copper. We clean it, place crushed glass on it in the form of whatever design we desire, and put it in the kiln at a very high temperature, and the temperature varies depending upon the design and the desire. I have one in the kiln. Let me take it out. It's a modern piece. Radiating lines. Ah, just right. This one that's cooling over here is quite unusual. It's an antique lace, circa 1872.
Do you want me to move? Hi, my name is Lori Lane. I'm an artist and I do paintings in acrylic. Most of the paintings that I do are on canvas. However, I've just recently started painting on furniture. I paint for a store in Westboro called Precious Baby. And the piece that I'm working on right now is a toy box. In fact, the toy box was built right here in Hubbardston by a guy over at Mount Jefferson Wood Products.
I'm Carol Arnold. I'm vice president of engineering and market development. I joined Wayne Roy in 1949 and have been with them mostly ever since that time. It was incorporated in 1948. It was a result of the work that was done by Vaino Holopainen and Roy Handy. In the mid-40s, they had developed a tractor rear loader for manure and for earth moving. And it later was developed into a backhoe, and you can see the original prototype of a backhoe being used here on the old Holopainen farm on the Barry Road. This was a progression of that, and it shows a backhoe that was first made as production units in 1948, and it was upon this development that the Wayne Roy Corporation was founded. Later on, backhoes were developed which were dug a little deeper and they had a little more swing, and in fact you can see myself in 1952 operating a new backhoe. This is the original Wayne Roy plant, which prior to its use for manufacturing was really, this portion here was a chicken coop, and this was the first expansion of Wayne Roy here, where the backhoes were made. It was a wooden frame building. Roy Handy, and Roy and was largely responsible for the development of the backhoe along with Wayne O'Holopainen, hence the name Wayne Roy. Backhoes were made for a number of years, and then later the whole vehicle was introduced, a backhoe, a loader, an all-one integrated unit, and that was introduced in 1961 to 1962, the first one being sold to the town of Westminster. This is the actually the world's first backhoe that was introduced to the market in 1948 and was the beginning of Wayne Roy as a corporation. This was the first tool of its kind that bridged the gap between the hand shovel and the old cable-operated shovels. This has grown now to be a multi-billion dollar operation, and most of the large tractor manufacturer and excavator manufacturers now build these nearly same units.
Was established in 1931. It became part of the Monadnock Council. For many years, Gordon M. Clark was the scoutmaster here in Hubbardston, 1932. Gordon, being an Eagle Scout, was known throughout the council for having what they call the Eagle's Nest right in here in Hubbardston, where he put out 10 Eagle Scouts.
This is a Chippewa kitchen. It was used by the Indians quite a while ago, quite a few centuries ago. They used it for cooking purposes. They would put their fires down at the bottom, hang pots, whatever. And we're gonna show you how to make one of these. It's real simple. It has lots of good uses, so We're going to make it now.
We have a full list of things that we do each year with the Scouts. We help out a lot at the field day that they have here in town every year. October, we usually have our fall camporee, which is usually held in different towns each year. Last year was in Athol. We do things like going roller skating. We went roller skating in October. We have our fundraisers, which is usually we sell Tom Watt in November to get ready for Christmas. We throw in little things like going swimming now and then, bowling, roller skating. Usually have a Christmas party at one of our meetings just before Christmas. Then in January, usually we start our freeze-outs, some of our winter camping. This past year, we've gone winter camping 3 times, twice here in Hubbardston and one up in Upik, Maine. Also in January, they have the Klondike Derbies every year, which is the sled races, when the boys pull the sleds from station to station to work on different skills, and they receive, it's all competition, and they receive awards for first and second place, and then at the end of the day, they have their Klondike race, which we usually do pretty good at. We also, in February, they have 3 weekends that they go away just for a Saturday morning for a merit badge college, which gives them a good opportunity to work on their merit badges with merit badge counselors in Gardner.
The scout uniform has changed over the years. It used to be an all drab green, various colors, and it's changed. They used to not have these things to hold epaulets. Like the epaulets are just used for, the scout has red ones. Executive scouts will have silver or gold. Explorers will have green. I should have green pretty soon. And Weeblos will have like a dark blue if they want to choose to wear the scout uniform. Steven here is a patrol leader. You had the town and your state, Hubbardston, Mass. And you had your troop. And we have 25 years of unbroken service. We would have had 50, but a while ago, the troop wasn't around for a year or so.
I'll call you Key West, something like that. He had a summer home in Hubbardston here. And he opened up the Gardner Council to the Boy Scouts to camp on his camp here in Hubbardston. It was the first camp right here for the Gardner Council, which later became the Monadnock Council. And then a few years later, they purchased the land around Lake Wampanoag, known as Camp Collier now, to open the activity.
In ending, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to spend this time with the troop. Hope a lot of boys out there get to see this. Boys joining the Scouts doesn't have to come right from Cub Scouts. They can join any time. And everybody's welcome. The troop is run by the boys, and it's for the boys. It's not for the adults, it's for the boys. And we'd love to get a lot more boys into it. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Officer Barrett, and I'm the advisor for the Hubbardston Police Explorer Group. I'm here to tell you just a little bit about the Explorer Group and what we do and what it benefits for the kids and the town. The Explorer Group is a division of the Boy Scouts, and it's for youth ages 14 through 21. And it's set to give the kids that are interested in a law enforcement field an idea of how it works and how we train. All the youths are certified in CPR in a first aid program, and as they develop their skills, they're allowed to ride in the cruisers. Out of this, they benefit by learning a law enforcement field and if they want to continue into that after they get out of high school or college. It just gives them a basic idea. Where it helps the town out is they donate their time to certain things such as field day, the bicycle rodeo, anything we can do to help out the town. They ride in the cruises, they're an extra set of eyes for us. And it gives us an opportunity when we need to hire police officers to pick off of them somebody that we already have an idea how they work and how they would work out as a police officer. So basically, we usually meet every other week, and we train anything from drugs, alcohol abuse, right up through fingerprinting, crime scene, everything that a police officer goes through. It's basically a mini academy that we provide for the kids.
My name is Dave Lucier. I live here in Hubbardston at 40 Cruz Road, and I hold the Hubbardston Star Watches. A group of us get together on Saturday nights here at my home on 40 Cruz Road to view the stars, planets, the Milky Way, galaxies, what have you. This is an 18-inch home-built telescope. It's a Newtonian reflector. This is the eyepiece up here where we look through. It's a finder scope, and it's got an 18-inch diameter, 2-inch thick mirror. This is Tammy. She came to our Star Watch tonight. And let me see. Did we? The interesting thing about this telescope is it's 4,000 power. And the rings of Saturn and the planet show up very nicely.
Right, these are all pictures of the Northern Lights. I photographed these on the morning of November 17th, 1989. This was the night of the morning, actually the very first Star Watch I ever had. You can see the nice red colors of the Northern Lights. The sky turned out blue because the sun was coming up. It's 5:45 in the morning, and the clouds were being illuminated by a quarter moon, and they came out green. This is a picture of the moon, how it would look through. This was taken through the 8-inch Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope, and this is about how it would look through a telescope. A picture like this is always—it's always so much sharper and clearer, and much more of an effect of being there. It's kind of like watching a baseball game in person versus on TV. It's nothing like being at the at Fenway Park to really appreciate the game. These are pictures of comets Levy and Austin. Comet Austin graced our skies in April of 1990. The Star Watches are advertised in the Gardner News in the Hubbardston section on Thursdays and Fridays generally. And the public is invited. If you ever drive by the house and see the telescopes in the driveway, by all means stop. The public is always welcome to look through my telescopes and ask any questions or bring your own telescope and I'll show you how to use it. Thank you.
Pastor of the Evangelical Congregational Church here in Hubbardston. I've been here since 1981, a little over 10 years now as pastor. This church was established in 1827. the people in charge then worshipped in a one-story building facing Williamsville Road. They saw the need years later for additional room, and they turned the church around, jacked it up, and established Sunday school classes underneath. It now sits in its present position, looking out on Main Street in between Williamsville Road and Route 68. We're a church that believes that Jesus can come into a person's life and change that life completely. Jesus came into the world to forgive and heal whosoever would come to him. This is Williamsville Chapel, which was established in 1888.
Hi, I'm Barbara Hubbard, and I'm here to talk about the first church in Hubbardston. It's the church on the common, and it was originally the first parish congregational Unitarian church. It was organized February 14, 1770. The frame of the meeting house was not raised until 1773, completed the following year. The porch and belfry were added in 1806, although the bell was installed in 1805. The clock was purchased in 1808, and stoves were added in 1830. Present church congregation is carrying on the Unitarian congregational tradition. The church is a federated church. It's a federation of congregational and Unitarian denominations. Everyone is welcome. We are served by the Reverend Ruth Martin, and we have Sunday school at 5:30, and we have church at 6:30 on Sunday evening.
I hope you enjoyed the movie as much as I enjoyed making it, and I wish to thank the many people that helped make this film possible. And in closing, here's Irene Heckler.
Oh, beautiful, for spacious skies,
I'm seeing.